Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Living with Leanne, written by Margaret Clark and read by Kate Hosking. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda Audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording, as well as on our new website, www.belinda.com. The book begins with the following dedication. To Tracy, who taught me a lot about living. Sam. Living with Leanne is like living on the edge of a dormant volcano. It's dead dangerous. She's a walking trouble capsule with a capital T. Sometimes I wish she'd disappear off the planet and stop making life hard for me, but she never does. I wish I could divorce her. There's a law for divorcing your parents, but as far as I know, there isn't one for divorcing your sister. I'm tempted to start a petition and get the kids at school to sign it. There's a whole heap of my mates with weird sisters, but they're mostly younger and nothing like Leanne. Some, like Kudja, have got horrible big brothers too, but no one's got a Leanne. I'd swap her tomorrow, but no one would take her on. Still, the lawmakers would have to do something if they got a petition signed by, say, a million kids, wouldn't they? Someone has to do something. It might as well be me. Divorcing a sister. Yes! I'm really calm and cool when Leanne's not dragging me into trouble. The bizarre thing is that lots of people, okay, mainly older guys, think my sister's fantastic. Right now she's got three of them spinning out of their skulls, losing their brains if she even just smiles at them. And she's only 15. But they don't live with her. It's halfway into the school year and I've finally settled into Bennett High. I can find my way round without getting lost. I can read the timetable, which means I must have the brain of a nuclear physicist. And I've got Belinda Blue Eyes, this girl who had the hots for me, but I was only lukewarm, sorted out. I'd better explain about Belinda. Her nickname's Bin. I thought I was in love with her, first girlfriend and all that, but I just managed to get away from Mum trying to hold my hand all the time and run my life by going to high school. Freedom. Then things started getting heavy with Bin. She wanted to hold my hand, run my life. Oh, I couldn't hack it. So now we're just friends. So, my life is excellent. Except for Leanne. It's late. Nearly lights out time at the Studley House of Horrors, our house. I'm sitting watching this cool sci-fi video while Mum's at bingo when Leanne slopes in with a bottle of Coke, two glasses, a packet of French onion chips and a plate of chocolate marshmallow biscuits all set out attractively on a tray. Thought you might like a snack, little bro? Let me tell you, Leanne never does anything nice for me, or Mum, without an ulterior motive. My brain cells go immediately to sus mode. What do you want? Just a chat. No need to get edgy. She flops down beside me. Mum's best Giorgio perfume that she won at a Meyer promotion has been sprayed on with a fireman's hose, and the smell chokes me, bringing tears to my eyes. How any female can think powerful perfume sexy is beyond me. It smells like cat's pee on Leanne, but that's probably because it's competing with Hold Set hairspray, floralette deodorant and Sweet as Breath mouthwash. Chatting with Leanne is dangerous. I grab two biscuits and cram them into my mouth before she says something gross to put me off the food. Sam boy, she says. Here it comes. What? Nothing drastic. A little favour. She leans across to pour me a Coke and her black mini rides up even higher. She's got these platform shoes on that make her legs go up to her ribs and this tight jumper, white, that makes her chest look like twin Mack truck headlamps. Her hair's wound round in this coil at the back with a dangling strand hanging down on one cheek. Jet black this week. She looks sideways at me with these black-rimmed eyes and lashes thick and spiky with black goop, and I choke on my chocolate biscuit. Leanne in conning mode is awesome. All I want you to do, she says, is cover for me. I've got a hot date. What? Now? It's nearly 10. We're supposed to be in bed by 10:30. Get real, says Leanne, taking a sip of Coke and leaving a thick red smear on the glass. Rockin' pneumonia doesn't stoke up till 10:30. You can't get in there. You're underage. Grow up, Sam. I can do anything. Yeah, and drag me under at the same time. Look, Leanne, I go, Mum's going to freak if you get sprung in rock and pneumonia. For a start, it's Slee City, and for another, the cops are right on to underage kids, and you're supposed to roll up to school tomorrow and... Oh, lighten up. Are you going to cover or not? Is there a choice? She grabs my arm and does this incredibly painful Chinese burn that screams right through the top of my head. No choice. Right, right! If Mum asks, I went to bed early. And when she's gone to bed, sneak down and take the key out of the lock, will you? Huh? I can't put my key in, can I, dog brain, if hers is already in there? She waves a key under my nose. A spare. Now, where did she... Don't bother asking. Stay cool, little bro. See ya. She's gone in a wiggle and a waft of perfume. Phew. Mum's going to smell a rat, a perfumed rat, if I don't do something. So I gulp the rest of the biscuits and chips and take the evidence to the kitchen. A car pulls up out the front, then roars away with a blast of sound to rival the Concorde. The Leanne-mobile. I get rid of the empty packets, rinse out the glasses and wipe them, and head back to the lounge room with the double-strength Mortine. I can say there was a cockroach. Now the whole room smells like Giorgio-scented fly spray, but... Too bad. A minute later, Mum's car chugs into the driveway. Talk about cutting it fine. I escape down the passage and dive into bed. I hear Mum open the back door and start messing round in the kitchen. Then I hear her go down the passage to the lounge room. Footsteps come back briskly. Next thing, my light snaps on and she's silhouetted against it.
Sam?
I pretend to be asleep.
I know you're awake. The TV's still warm. Have you been smoking?
Huh? I sit bolt upright.
Someone sprayed the lounge room with fly spray.
Phew, she hasn't sussed out the Giorgio.
Oh, I saw a cockroach. Rubbish. You're trying to cover up the smell of something. I used to spray fly killer all over my mum's house when I'd been smoking.
You used to smoke? You never told us that. So how come you won't let Leanne smoke then?
Ah, Leanne, says Mum, narrowing her eyes. Where is she?
In bed, I suppose. I burrow down under the blankets and hope Mum will decide not to investigate. But hope's not an option in this house.
Sam!
What? How am I supposed to sleep? I'll look like a wrinkly tomorrow morning at this rate.
Come here!
I drag out of bed and stagger down the passage. She's in Leanne's room, light blazing, pointing at the bed. Okay, so I know Leanne's not going to be in it, but I fake full-on surprise when I'm shown two pillows wearing Leanne's nightie.
Where is she, Sam?
Dunno. I mumble, eyes down. Mum can tell if I'm lying just by glancing at my eyeballs. Anyway, I don't exactly know where she is right at this minute, do I? She could be at rockin' pneumonia. She could be in some dude's car gazing at the full moon. She could be lying under a bridge murdered.
She's probably lying under a bridge murdered! Says Mum. That girl will come to a sticky end. I just know it. She'll be the death of me one day, Sam. Get dressed.
Huh?
You heard me. We're going to look for Leanne.
Great. Just what I need. A late night cruise through the city searching for my sister.
But Mum... Dress now!
I go to my room and drag on jeans and a wind cheater. By the time I reach the back door, Mum's got the engine running and gives it a few revs so it won't conk out. But she's out of luck. It splutters and dies. She fiddles round with the ignition, then looks at me. I sigh, go round to the passenger side, open the door, get the special banging spanner from the glove box, sleepwalk to the front of the Falcon, raise the bonnet, and give the terminals a bash. The motor groans and coughs, but at least it's going. I slam the bonnet and go back to the passenger side.
Lock the screen door, Sam!
Well, that solves one problem. With luck, Leanne will be able to work her key really well in the empty lock if she gets home before us, because I've got the key in my hand. I pile in the front of the Falcon next to Mum and we're away on our mission from God to save Leanne.
I don't know, Mum grinds the gears. I've brought that girl up decently, given her all the love and attention a single parent can, tried to discipline her, and what thanks do I get?
If the police find her roaming round the streets, they'll say I can't control her. They'll take her away and make her a ward of the state. I bite my tongue from asking if we'll have to make compulsory visits to Wardsville and pretend to look out the window as we're searching. We cruise up and down the city streets for a while till we come to this long, curling queue of night people going somewhere. "This could be it," says Mum, double parking. She winds down the window and I cringe under the dashboard. "Where's this line going, Sonny?"
"Heaven and back, man,"
says this guy, sprayed with black leather.
"That sounds like Leanne,"
says Mum grimly, jumping out of the car.
"Come on, Sam."
She street sweeps right to the front of the queue, surveys the blazing, pulsating lights of rock and pneumonia and presses her lips together in a thin line. She looks straight at me.
"She's in here, isn't she?"
I nod. "Okay, so I'm a moderate dobber, but it's a bit late for heroics. We're here, aren't we? And Mum's hell-bent on finding Leanne and hauling her home by the scruff of the neck, so I might as well hurry up the process."
"Hey, fat stuff, back of the queue!"
"Go drown in a puddle," says Mum and shoves her aside. She's up to the red carpet now and the bouncers blink in surprise, their faces pale under the pulsating rock and pneumonia sign.
"You're too old, love," says one, grinning at Mum. "You can get a toy boy down at the Sophisticats, so I suggest..."
But Mum doesn't back down. She stands, hands on hips, and glares at the guy. He's built like a pharaoh's tomb, all body and small pointed head, which probably houses a small pointed brain.
"Aren't you Ronnie Pike?"
"So, what's it to you, Granny?"
"I used to mind you every Thursday and Friday when you were four,"
she says.
"So?"
He couldn't care less, and that gets right up Mum's nose. She probably nurtured that kid with Vegemite sandwiches and orange juice, and I can read her mind like an open book. Why did she bother if this was the result? Mum faces the crowd triumphantly.
"He used to poo his pants every day at preschool,"
she shouts, and the crowd cracks up laughing. While he's cringing and his mates gaping like a lost hippopotamus with toothache, Mum's yanked me inside.
$10 each,
says this bored-looking female with long blonde hair which she keeps swishing back with one hand like a robotic Barbie doll.
Forget it, says Mum. We're not staying.
We're on a mission, I mumble as I follow Mum into the gloom.
Hey!
It's more security in the form of the Incredible Hulk. He grabs Mum by the arm.
Where do you think you're going, missus? Straight to the cops if you don't let go,
says Mum.
There's a 15-year-old kid in here, possibly more.
He pales. This place has already been in mega trouble for letting in underage kids. The guy backs off and Mum elbows her way through the crowd. I wish I could fade into the wallpaper.
I'm going to the dunny,
I rasp and make a dive sideways, but Mum's too quick.
You can hang on,
she hisses. Ronnie Pike mightn't be the only punter that ever pooed his pants in public, I'm thinking, as we push and shove through the pulsating bodies. Someone slops beer all over my windcheater, and someone else nearly pokes my eye out with a strange-smelling cigarette.
Marijuana,
says Mum, frowning and scanning the crowd. How does she know all this stuff? But she doesn't know rock and pneumonia. It's this humongous place which used to be St. Giles Church, a grim bluestone building built in the 1800s, but this mob bought it up when it was for sale, put in two stories, chucked out the pews and made double dance floors. It's cool. Strobe lighting, laser shows, soft porn movies, pulse music, giveaways, grog promos, wet t-shirt competitions, full on sleaze. I can't wait to be 18 and legal. Neither can anyone else in this city who's underage. It's like a giant magnet. Twice a year, just as a teaser, they hold an alcohol-free underage twilight disco from 6 till 10, and everyone who's anyone motors on in. Last time there were 1,400 kids in here and another 500 pounding on the doors to get in because they had Scott Michelson from Neighbours and Surf Mania giveaways. Oh, it was great. Belinda and Kathy queued overnight and saved us places, otherwise we'd never have got inside the doors. Mum doesn't know that I was here with Belinda, Kudja, Kathy and the gang from school. She thought we went to Bambi 3. She thinks the underage stuff in this place is just hooking us into decadent behaviour and the pub scene when we're 18. But that teeny bopper stuff's tame compared to the proper nightclub scenario. It's every kid's dream to get into the rock and pneumonia adult nightclub on a fake ID, a game to beat the authorities. But it's not every kid's dream to get in here with their mother. That's every kid's nightmare, including mine, and it's just come true. Not my scene, and definitely not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.